الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى that he protects us from fitna and he protects us and keeps us firm upon his religion. Likewise we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he makes us firm upon la ilaha illallah until we meet him. This is the fourth session where we are looking at the book Hadith fil Fitan wal Hawadith by Sheikh Muhammad ibn Wahhab, where he has gathered a number of hadith where he is talking about the calamities that are going to occur and the events which will then signify the establishment of the hour. And in last week's session we looked at two chapters previous to today's chapter, which is Bab La Ya'ti Zamanun Illa Walladhi Ba'dahu Sharrun Min. And this is a hadith from the Prophet ﷺ. He said, "Isbiru, be patient, because there is not going to be a time except that the time that comes after it will be worse." Meaning, each year things are going to get worse, each generation things are going to get worse. And it's not going to get better. And we said last time, some people might see this as being, you know, a conspiracy, some kind of a theory, some kind of projection about what's going to happen in the future, but this is an issue of Iman for us. Whatever you see in the dunya, it's not going to get better. Then we had a chapter after that, Bab Halak Al-Ummah Ba'duhum Bi-Ba'd, that the Ummah will be destroyed because of what they will do to one another. And what we learn from this chapter is that the fitna will occur in stages. The fitna will occur in stages. And here we have two hadith which we looked at last week. Both of them be reported by Muslim in his Sahih, one on the authority of Thawban, another one on the authority of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua. He made a lengthy sujood and he asked for three things. Sa'altu Rabbi thalathan, I asked my Lord for three things. Fa'atani thintain wa mana'ani wahida. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me two things, but he prevented me from the third. The first thing that he asked his Lord, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted for him, that this ummah will not be destroyed like the ummahs that came before us. A complete destruction from divine punishment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave this to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Meaning the hour is not going to be established with all of the believers being destroyed in one go. The second thing that we learn from this hadith is that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, "O Allah, make it that those people who are not from my ummah," meaning the ummah, ad-da'wah, meaning the disbelievers, "don't make it that they are superior to the ummah istijaba, those who have given the response," meaning the ummah who are the believers in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. "Fa'ataniha," the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Allah granted this for me." Therefore, there is no fitna that's going to occur except that the believers can withstand it. There is no fitna that's going to occur except that the believers have something which will help them to be successful over it. But then I asked for a third thing, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his hadith of Muslim. أَلَّا يَجَلْ بَأْسَهُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't create them to be disunited, meaning the Muslim ummah. That they don't start fighting one another, that they don't deviate from the correct path, that their aqidah doesn't split up and their manhaj doesn't split up. فَمَنَائِهَا, Allah's Messenger said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah prevented him from having that. These two chapters are very important before we take today's. Why? Because of the fact that the author is saying here, number one, time is going to get worse, fighting is going to get worse, and this is something that we've looked at before. There's going to be more corruption, oppression, bloodshed. Fighting is going to fill the globe, may Allah protect us. But then the second thing that we've learned here is that the ummah will always have people who will withhold and withstand the fitna. And they will be triumphant and they will be superior despite the fact that they're going to go through difficulties. Now, what we learn from this, now this is very important, because today's chapter, what we're going to look at, the author says, min amarat as-sa'ah, he talks about, before we get into the major signs, something which is very important, which is the final minor sign before the major signs occur, is that there will be a particular war between the believers and the disbelievers. And the head of that army will be the Mahdi himself. Min Amarat al-Sa'ah. This is a minor sign. Then the following chapter, so these are the two chapters that we're going to look at. Bab Malahim al-Rum. The great war that's going to happen with the Romans, between the Muslims and the Romans. Now, with the recap that we have done, and with these two chapters, it's very important now for us to understand that things have already begun to move. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we said this before also, that if you see something which reminds you as a sign of the establishment of the hour, we can't say for certain that this is exactly what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was referring to. However, things are moving. The globe is not the same that it looked like 5-10 years ago. And they are moving fast. People are as if they are being put into different camps. Some countries are becoming very extreme, and other countries are becoming almost unbearable to live in. There is a lot of fitna in certain regions. Things are moving, and the nature of the fitna is that fitna is confusing. And this is what we said before in the very first session, what is fitna? And one of the best ways that the ulama have explained what fitna is that when things cannot be told from what is right from what is wrong, you can't differentiate the difference anymore. The liar seems like the truthful person seems like the liar. And this is something that we'll look at in more detail next week, because the coming of a Dajjal will be extremely, extremely immense fitna for the people that will witness it. And one of the biggest reasons why is that the description, everybody is waiting for someone. Even the mushriks are waiting, even the Hindus are waiting for a god to return, even the Sikhs, all these people, they are waiting for something. Our religion, we know that this is going to happen, this is wahi that has been informed to us. The Jews are waiting, the Christians are waiting, the Muslims are waiting, the whole world is waiting for someone. Why is the fitna of the Masih al-Dajjal particularly the greatest fitna? Because the description that they have of the Dajjal is actually the description that they will apply to Isa ibn Maryam. So when they see Isa ibn Maryam, they'll say he's the Dajjal. And when they see the Dajjal, what do they believe in now, all these people? The Hindus, the Sikhs, the Jews, the Christians. Again, we're not here to offend anyone, we're just plaining. We are just stating plain facts. Every single one of these religions believe that there is a creator inside of the creation. All of these religions believe that God can exist inside of a man. This is what they're about to celebrate. This is what they have just celebrated. All of these religions believe in something. Right. So when the Dajjal actually comes down and he says, I am a prophet. And when Isa ibn Maryam comes down and says, I'm a follower of Muhammad. I'm not the son of God. I'm here to tell you about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which one will they believe? They're not going to believe in Isa ibn Maryam. They're going to say, he is the Dajjal. He is the one that we need to fight and kill. And when they see the Dajjal, he says, look, I'll make it rain. Tell me, I'll make it rain. You want crops, I'll make it. And we will look at the fitna that he will come with in more detail next week. He'll bring your parents. In the shape of shayateen, he'll bring your parents. And your parents will say to you, Allah protect us, he will say to the people, believe in him. So now these people who are extremely superstitious people who believe in the existence of God inside of the creation, which one is it likely that they're going to believe? They're going to call this one a radical, a follower of Muhammad, a person who is not on the right way, but he's actually the Masih, Isa ibn Maryam, alayhi salam. Fitna. Fitna, the reason why we've got to this discussion here is that the nature of fitna is that it is so confusing, you cannot tell what is right from what is wrong. And it's already begun. People are talking about Islam, people are leaving Islam, people have ideas about Islam because of the fitna of the time that we live in. Okay, the author is now saying now, we have reached hadith number 91. Now, but this is very important. What we learn from this chapter here and the previous chapters, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from what he has told us from the anbiya that came before, they have seen fitna themselves. There has never been a Nabi except that he called his nation to the oneness of Allah. And they rejected, most of them. So he's seen the fitna from the people, and he's seen the divine punishment that has come. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? وَنَجَّيْنَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. And we saved those people who believed and they had taqwa. So don't despair. The fitna is going to get worse. But the solution, as we have seen in the previous two chapters, is there. From the very beginning actually. The very first hadith, بَادِرُ بِالْعَمَالِ. Allah's Messenger ﷺ said, hasten to do good deeds. Before fitna that comes, كَخِتَعِ اللَّيْلِ مُذْلِمِ. Just like the darkness of a night. Tense fitna. But he told you, your solution is there, and to prepare. Therefore don't despair, don't become anxious, don't become worried about these things. But you have to know these things. And this is part of your iman. And this is the way that you can save yourself. If you don't know these things, what's going to happen? You're going to be sucked into the fitna because of your ignorance, and you're going to fall, may Allah protect us. And one of the most strangest things that we're going to see in today's chapter or chapters is you will find Muslims moving from one location to another location for the sake of removing the fitna or fighting against the fitna. And it might even be that they move from a virtuous place and they make hijrah from that virtuous place to a less virtuous place for the sake of their fitna. Now, I don't want to mention any Muslim countries, we don't want that kind of attention to ourselves, but a lot of people are worried about what's happening in certain Muslim countries. To the extent that in these Muslim countries now, if you were to practice Tawheed, if you were to speak the truth, something bad might happen to you. Is it now conceivable in the world that we live in now, that in order to protect your religion, you have to leave from a Muslim country to perhaps another Muslim country, or perhaps even a non-Muslim country to protect your religion? Can you see the fitna? You're living in a Muslim country and you can't practice the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fitna. And this is what we're going to see here. An army will come out from Al-Madinah and it will leave Al-Madinah to go to Sham. When today you might think, well, if I want to protect myself from fitna, I'd leave Sham and go to Medina. Min Amarat al-Sa'a. Now, the author, like I said, we're not going to get into the major signs today. The first major sign, well, actually, the third chapter, which we're not going to do today, there are three chapters. Min Amarat al-Sa'a, Bab al-Malahim, or al-Malhama, al-Rum, the fighting that's going to happen with the Romans. And then the author has a chapter which he talks about Dukhan. Now what seems to be the correct view is that Dukhan, the smoke that will come out, and this will be explained inshallah in due course, is not the first major sign. Although the author has put it here, and this seems to be his opinion. And again, this is an issue of khilaf, and we'll talk about this in more detail when we start the major signs. Is that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in certain hadith, he listed the major signs, in another hadith, he listed them in a different way. So the ulama have differed. Which is the first one? What is the correct order? And what seems to be the correct view is that the very first major sign is the coming of Dajjal. Up until then are all minor. And we talked about the minor in more detail, about 40 or 50 minor signs. So now, this is another minor one. After the battle with the Romans, after that has been concluded, the Muslims will hear of a call that the Dajjal has been released or he has come out, and they will hasten towards the east to go fight. But they will not be able to destroy him, and a lot of people will be killed. But look at the strength of the iman and the strength of the taqwa. So today we're going to talk about the first major battle that's going to happen towards the end of time between the believers and the disbelievers. Next week's session we've got, so next week's session, session number 5, is a detailed description of the coming of the Dajjal. What will he look like? What will he bring? What are some of his tricks that he will play? And how will the believers repel him? And how will he be destroyed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Then the coming of Isa ibn Maryam. Then the Ya'juj and Ma'juj, then the smoke, and then some of the other major signs we will see inshallah in the coming session. Min Amarat al-Sa'a. In Sahih al-Bukhari, it's a hadith number 91, we have reached from 200. It's on the authority of Auf ibn Malik. And in this hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lists 8 minor signs before the establishment of the Day of Judgment. And we have seen this before in the previous sessions where we were talking about minor signs. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained in detail the establishment of the hour, and sometimes he'd explain minor sign after minor sign after minor sign after minor. So we can add this to the list that we've had before. But the reason why this is here in a separate chapter is because the next chapter is talking about the battle with the Romans, and this hadith explains that. So in Bukhari, on the authority of Auf ibn Malik, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after the battle of Tabuk, and the battle of Tabuk was with who? The Romans. So after the battle of Tabuk, he explains that this is going to happen again. And then he said, "Adud sittan bayni laysa," count with me 6, but in actual fact, we can separate them and make them more than 6, but we'll say that the Messenger of Allah said that there were 6 signs that are going to happen before the establishment of the hour. Number 1, mawti. The fact that I have come and I will die. And when I die, this is a sign that the hour is not far away. When I die, this is a sign that the hour is not far away. The Messenger of Allah died 1400 years ago, more than. And all Muslims think, okay. He said he's going to die, and the hour is going to come. Still not come. I can relax. But this is a misconception. And this is a problem. Because throughout history, how long has man existed? And when the Messenger of Allah said, and he spoke the truth always, that after me, there's not going to be long left. So even if there's another 1,000 years, even if there's another 1,000 years after that, he spoke the truth in the sense that the hour is close because of the chronological situation of man. But also, after I die, the fitna is going to open. And your situation is going to get worse. Number 1. Number 2, ثم فتح بيت المقدس. And this happened at the time of Umar رضي الله عنه. Bayt al-Maqdis will become Muslim territory. They gave him the keys. They made a treaty, and that treaty, as far as I understand, still exists and still is erected. The opening of Bayt al-Maqdis. Now, number 3, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, death will come. ثم موتان يأخذكم قعاس الغنم. You know, sometimes if sheep, they get attacked by wolves or something like that, if a wolf attacks a pen, or what do you call it, a gathering of sheep, you'll find them all dead. You come in the morning, gone. He won't just leave one or two behind. He'll just kill them for the sake of killing them, the wolf, even if he doesn't want to eat them. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, another sign before the establishment of the hour is death will spread like that when you see the sheep just dead. What killed this thing? We don't know. Why did it kill? We don't know. Just death everywhere. Death. Number 4. ثُمَّ إِسْتِفَادَةُ الْمَالِ. Then wealth will spread. We did this before. Wealth will spread. To the extent that you will give a man 100 dinar, and he will think that this is something insignificant. 1 dinar is roughly four grams of gold. So if you times that by, and one gram of gold is roughly around 50 pounds, I'm just guessing, okay? So how much is 1 dinar? 4 times 50? 4 times 50? 200 roughly. Now times that by 100. 2,000? That's times by 10. 200,000. That's times by 100. 20,000. You give a man 20,000 pounds, he thinks that this is nothing. Now we've quantified what the Messenger. You give him, يُؤْتِ الرَّجُلْ مِئَ دِينَارْ فَيَذُلُّ سَاحَدًا. And he just thinks that this is nothing. If somebody gave you 20,000 pounds, nothing. Can't get me anything. ثم فتنة لا يبقى بيت من العرب إلا دخلته. Then there will be a fitna. And what the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentions here is that Arab lands will be full of this fitna, meaning the Muslims will be full of this fitna. There is no house except that this fitna, whatever nature of this fitna is that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying here, but the word fitnatun is nakira, is general in its understanding and its application. All forms of fitna will enter the houses of the Muslims. When Sheikh Saleh Fawzan was explaining this book, they asked him, does it refer to the TV? And he says, Allahu A'lam, meaning is possible. And this was explained, the Sheikh Saleh Fawzan, when he was explaining this some 10, 15 years ago. Now it's even worse with mobile phones and tablets and things like that. Thumma fitna, there will be a fitna that will enter into every single home. Now, here's the point. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, then there will be a treaty between the Muslims and Banu Asfar. Who's Banu Asfar? The Romans. There will be a treaty. فَيَغْدِرُونَ. So now I'm counting these separately, even though the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said six, but I'm only mentioning them separately because of the fact that it makes it easy for us to understand. So now, if you count them, there are six. But then they will break the treaty, is another sign if you want. They will have, the believers will have an agreement with a large superpower, if you want, who are the Romans in Europe. And they will break it. And then there will be a huge war, تحت 80 غاية, under 80 battalions. تحت كل غاية 12,000. Underneath each battalion, there's going to be 12,000 soldiers. 12,000 soldiers under 80 battalions. You can see how big this war is going to be. Even to today's standards, we're talking about, you know, if you've got troops going, I don't know, I mean, America pulled out their troops from Afghanistan, how many were there? 20,000, 30,000, 40,000, something like that. The ones that were remaining. Here we are talking about 80 battalions, and in each battalion there's going to be 12,000. Bab Malahim al-Rum. Now, Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu was sitting in Kufa in a masjid. Usayr ibn Jabir, he said, I went to Ibn Mas'ud and I wanted to find out from him about the establishment of the hour. And he was lying down in the masjid. So when I asked him this question, he got startled and he sat up, became very serious. This is not something that you should be lying down about. When he's talking about this topic, he sat up and he was scared and he was concentrating and he was focused and he's being sincere in his warning. And he's telling you to concentrate. And this is what he said now. فَقَعَدَ. Then he sat up. فَقَالْ إِنَّ السَّاعَ. I heard from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the hour will not be established until a great deal of wealth will be fought over. Meaning there's going to be a battle between two armies and a great deal of wealth will be given to the victors, you know, the people that will win. And then he pointed towards the east, meaning from where he was, he pointed towards his right hand side, he pointed towards Sham. Adu yajma'un li ahl al-Islam. He said, this is going to be a group of people from that direction, that they are going to be an enemy, that are going to fight against Islam. Not Arabs, not Somalis, not Pakistanis, against Islam. It's a fight, it's a battle between Muslims and non-Muslims. That's how it's going to be. So I asked him, Usayr ibn Jabir, do you mean the Romans? Ar-Rum ta'ani. Are you referring to the Romans that they are going to fight? I believe he said yes. So then he said, I heard from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that there's going to be an immense battle and the Muslim ruler at that time will take an allegiance from the people of Islam that you are going to take part until death or victory. There's nothing else. Death or victory. They will fight for 3 days. فَيَقْتَتِلُونَ حَتَّى يُمْسَى. On day one, they will fight from the morning until the evening. It's not easy. It's very tiring. But they will fight until Maghrib. فَيَبْقَى هَؤُلَى وَهَؤُلَى. كُلٌّ غَيْرُ غَالِبٌ. This group, the Muslims, will have people that will remain and they will have casualties. And this group will have people that will remain and they will have casualties. And nobody has won. Day two, they will come back. Same thing. They will fight until night time. A lot of casualties here, a lot of casualties there. They will say, we'll go at it again tomorrow. Remember, what's the condition? Death or victory. Then the third day will happen, the same thing. Then the fourth day, فَإِذَا كَانَ يَوْمُ الرَّابِعِ نَهَدِ إِلَيْهِمْ بَقِيَةَ أَهْلِ الْإِسْلَامِ. The people of Muslims will overcome them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make them victorious. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in describing this battle that takes place, there will be so much fighting to the extent that birds will not be able to fly over them. حتى إن الطير تمر بجانب. Allah knows best. Allah knows best. Okay, this is a very interesting question. Some of the ulama have been asked, are we going to go back to the state that where we were, or are we going to have the technical advances that we have? And when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said swords and camels and horses, he's just talking about what was understood at that time. Some of the ulama have taken it to mean literal. So as we will see next week, Dajjal will have a sword with him and he'll cut a man half. He'll cut another man half. He'll have a sword with him. He'll have a donkey with him. People will be on horseback. People will be on camelback. So some of the ulama have said this is going to go back. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Because of the thing that we are living in today, they're talking about, what are they saying, climate change, and they're talking about fossil fuels running out and all these different things. Who knows? To the extent that the scientists have even said that, you know, the sun, if it has a solar, I can't remember what it's called, a solar tornado or something like that. Yeah. The sun emits rays and it emits lava and all these different things that come out from the sun. It's happening all the time. But the scientists are saying here, some of these things which come out from the sun, if it reaches Earth, it will completely annihilate all satellites and electricity, everything. Everything will just collapse. Allah knows best. No, Allah is able to do whatever he wants. Right, that's one view. Another view from the ulama is that these things possibly can still remain. Chemical weapons, technology and all these things, they can possibly still remain. And essentially, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, and it doesn't change the situation at all. The fact that these things are going to happen will happen. And the way that it happens, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the kayfiyat. Right, so here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how it will happen. Right, so now the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this battle will be so intense that birds will not be able to fight on top of it. The believers in this narration here of Muslim, the believers will overcome them. And the Romans will be defeated. And we will see another description in the next hadith that the Romans, okay, so there's another hadith now from Abu Hurairah. Let me just try and bring them together for the sake of the presentation. After day one, after day two, the Christians will then say, because they've got a lot of defeat, people killed on the Muslim side, they've got a lot of people that have been killed on the non-Muslim side, the Christians will now say, we have become successful because of the cross. The cross has defeated Islam. Then the Muslims will say, wallahi, what was their agreement? What was their allegiance? Fight till death or until victory. The cross will never overcome Islam. And then they will continue fighting and fighting until the Muslims will actually overcome the Romans, until they can't say anything anymore. Then, in this hadith going back to Muslim, فَجَاءَهُمْ أَسْرِيخ. A caller will call out, a scream will come, إِنَّ الدَّجَّال قَدْ خَلَقَهُمْ فِي ذِرَارِهِمْ. Dajjal has come out, and he has come from that direction. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the fawaris, meaning the horse riders, going back to your point there, they will go and they will head towards the direction of the Masih Dajjal. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنِّي لَعَارَفُ أَسْمَاءَهُمْ وَأَسْمَاءَ أَبَائِهِمْ وَأَلْوَانُ خُيُورِهِمْ. I know these people, their names, I know their father's names, and I know even the colour of their horses. These are the best people on earth on that day. This is a hadith in Muslim. The next hadith, again in Muslim, but on the authority of Abu Hurairah. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the hour will not be established until an army comes out from Medina. So this now is explained the previous one. And this is the point that we were making earlier. People often think, let's make hijrah to Makkah and to Medina. At that time, the fitna is going to be so great, people are going to be leaving the Muslim lands, going towards the non-Muslims, in order to eradicate the fitna. فَيَخْرُجُ إِلَيْهِمْ جَيْشْ مِنْ مَدِينَ. An army will come out from Medina, and the head of them will be the Mahdi. So now, the Romans, after battle, they will say that we have become successful because of the cross, the fighting will continue. Just before they are defeated, they will say, let's call for a truce. Let's call for a truce, an agreement. Let's go back to being friends again. And the believers say, no. Because remember the hadith in the previous one in Bukhari, the authority of Auf bin Malik, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَيَلْدِرُونَ. They will have a truce in the beginning, but they will break that treaty. So they will say, now we're not going to do that again. We're not going to fall into that same mistake again. And they will continue fighting until the believers will become victorious. And in this narration here, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us something that we need to be worried about. The Muslim army that are behind the Mahdi will be split into three. One group that will run. One group will run. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la yatubu Allah alayhim abada. Their tawbah will never be accepted. So there are three categories behind the Mahdi. First one, they will run. That leaves two-thirds of the army. Another group, they will be killed. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, afdhu shuhada inda Allah. They are the best of the martyrs with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third group, that will become victorious over the Romans. And now, we said this before last week, once the Romans are defeated, Istanbul, Constantinople, will then be liberated and become Muslim land. They will hear the call that the Dajjal has come out. So now the fighting has gone towards the west into Turkey. They hear the call that the Dajjal is going to come out. Where is he going to come out from? From Isfahan. He's going to come out from Isfahan. So where's that? Where's Isfahan? In Iran. He's going to come out from the east. So they will head towards the east, and they will start their battle in Sham. And in this narration here in Muslim, they will lead Salatul Fajr with the Mahdi, and that's when the Isa will descend, and he will lead the army against the Dajjal. There's other hadith that the author has mentioned, but they are similar, they are quite lengthy. Yes, Muslim, what's your question? Yeah, he will be the leader at the time, yes. People will make it. Okay, so this is important that the author has not mentioned. And it's very unfortunate that we won't be able to go through each aspect in further detail and more detail than we perhaps would have liked to, because of the fact that we need to stick to what the author has given us. Perhaps, inshallah, in the future, maybe we can talk about the Mahdi in more detail. But what we are trying to do is go through these hadith. But there are hadith and things that have been mentioned about the Mahdi. The Mahdi will be recognized in Makkah. And some of the ulama have said that these narrations are weak, but what seems to be the case is that these are sound in their acceptance. He will be in Makkah. And the ulama of Makkah will recognize him between the Rukn al-Imani and the Hajr al-Aswad. And they will give him bayah. And initially he'll say, no, I'm just a normal man, etc. Until he will be convinced. And he will be convinced, and it will be explained to him, look, your lineage goes back to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's another characteristic of the Mahdi. And your name is Muhammad ibn Abdullah, the same name as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you have such and such characteristics that have been explained in the hadith. You are the Mahdi, this is how we recognize you. The people will give him bayah, and he will become the Muslim ruler. He will then go back to Medina, and then the fight will be taken out under his banner as him being the ruler. But this is something that we need to also understand, is that even Muslims now, I say Muslims, I mean even Sunnis now, are saying that there is a Mahdi that we are waiting for. Are we waiting? Is there a Mahdi Muntadhar or not? There's no such thing. This is what the Rawafid and the Shia believe. Because they are waiting for one final infallible Imam who has the same characteristics and the Asma and Sifat as Allah. This is what they believe about their Imams. So they believe that this man is going to come, the Mahdi, and he is going to bring success. Now what did we say in the beginning? When the Mahdi truly comes, he says, believe in the oneness of Allah. I don't believe in these Abdal, I don't believe in these Ayatollahs, I don't believe in all these things. What are they going to say? He says, he's not the Mahdi. Fitna. But when the Dajjal comes in, I'll be your Ayatollah. I'll be your Abdal, I'll be the one that can control all of the creations, etc. Who are they going to follow? Allah al-Musta'an. And again, there are other narrations which tell us that the Dajjal will come out from Asfahan, which is in Iran, بَيْنَ أَذْهُرِ الْخَوَارِجِ, and he will be surrounded by the Khawarij. This is in Muslim Ahmad. So now the Khawarij now, who are already there in that region, who are pretending to fight for Islam, but they never attack Tehran or Iran for some reason, but they attack all these other Muslim Sunni countries, innocent people in the masjids, worshipping Allah. What's going to happen? Who are they going to follow? The Mahdi, who they claim that they already, you know, created the banner for? Fitna. Yes, Muslim.
So, you said that the Khalifa at the time is going to say to the Muslims that you have to fight until then.
Yes, that's going to be what's going to happen. And
yeah, he's there at the same time.
He's going to be the leader. The Mahdi is going to be the leader of the army. He's going to be saying, now fight till the end. And this is why the Messenger of Allah said, there will be two groups that will fight till the end. One will be victorious, one will become shuhada. The other one will run, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never accept their tawbah. Right, these people now have had, the Dajjal has come out. Where do they head? They head towards Shambhal. Salatul Fajr is then established. The Mahdi leads the Salah. Isa has come down, alayhi salam. In more detail, this is going to come in this relevant chapter. He will then run after the Dajjal, and the Dajjal will run away from him, Isa ibn Maryam, until Isa will make dua. He will stand in front of him and he will make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ذاب كما يذوب المثل ما, he will dissolve like when you get salt and you put it in water, or sugar when you put it in water. What happens? Can you see the sugar at the end? Nothing, completely gone. That's what has happened to the Dajjal. Yesterday he said he was your Lord. This is how he ends. In another hadith here now, in Muslim. Now look at this hadith. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, when he is talking about the establishment of the hour and the fighting, etc., that the believers at that time, they will say, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. The more they make dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will see that they will overcome the Romans. How will they defeat the Romans? This is a hadith in Muslim, on authority of Abu Huraira, that the battle will intensify and they will increase in making dhikr of Allah. La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. They will have advancements. They will defeat them. More of them, the opposite people, will die. فَيُفَرِّجُ لَهُمْ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then give them an opening and a victory over their enemy, and then they will take all of their wealth. And as we've seen in the very first hadith, there will be a great deal of wealth. As they are dividing the wealth, there's a lot of wealth now. You can see it already, the Romans. As they are dividing the wealth, a person will call out that the Dajjal has come out, and they will leave all of that wealth behind and they will head towards fighting the Dajjal. In another hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Istanbul will be open, Constantinople will be open, by tasbih and takbir. meaning the Romans will be defeated. How? Through fighting? No, no. By making tasbih of Allah, subhanallah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Obviously they will be fighting, but what we're saying here is that they will gain their strength and their victory from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more they make dhikr of Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. How long will it be between this battle and the coming out of the Dajjal? In a hadith that's been reported by Tirmidhi, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there will be a malhama al-kubra, there will be a great battle between the believers and the Romans, which we have just talked about. The believers will overcome them and Istanbul will be taken over. And 6 months will go by, and in the seventh month, that's when the Dajjal will be announced, and that's when he will come out. That's when the believers will go and fight him. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in another narration here, بين الملحمة وفتح المدينة, meaning Istanbul, 6 sinin, ويخرج الدجال في السابعة. The battle will go on between the believers and the disbelievers for a period of 6 years. One particular battle will take a number of months. So ongoing battles here and there, here and there, here and there, for 6 years. And then, one of the biggest battles that will take place will take for a number of months. And then after that, 6-7 months later, the Dajjal will come out. Therefore, this is one of the biggest things that will happen before the first major sign, which is the coming of the Dajjal. Well-known hadith, number 99, the author now brings the hadith of Thawban. يُشْفَ الْأُمَمْ أَنْ تَدَعَ عَلَيْكُمْ كَمَا تَدَعَ الْأَكْلُ إِلَىٰ قَسْعَتِهَا. Soon, the people will gather around a table to discuss how they are going to attack Islam, just like they sit around when they have a meal together. If I bought pizza now, how would we sit? We'd sit close to each other. You wouldn't sit far away from each other, you'd sit close so everyone can benefit from the food. This is what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that they will sit close. How can we destroy Islam? All of the leaders, all of the people of power, they will sit close to each other. What can we do to destroy Islam? Now, the companions asked, now they're worried about Islam, they're worried about the Muslims, this is how much they loved us, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. مِنْ قِلَّةِ نَحْنُ يَوْمَئِذٍ, they asked, Ya Rasulullah, is it because they're going to be able to defeat us easily and they're going to wipe the floor with us? Because we're so small in number? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, بَلْ أَنْتُمْ كَثِيرٌ, rather you're going to be a large number. But what's going to happen is that you are going to have in your heart a connection to the life of this dunya. حُبَّ الدُّنْيَا وَكَرَاهِيَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Therefore, there's two things that we learn from this narration which will cause the Muslim Ummah from now until then for them to become inferior. Any kind of issue that the Muslim Ummah is having. Number one, they want to live the life of this dunya. They are connected to the life of this dunya and they've forgotten the Akhirah. And number two, because they have forgotten the Akhirah, they do not prepare for it, so they're not concerned about death. Hadith number 100 in Muslim, on the authority of Abu Hurairah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the hour will not be established until the Euphrates River in Iraq uncovers gold, a mountain of gold. Because there's a lot of gold there that's free, what's going to happen? People are going to rush there and they want that gold for themselves. People will start fighting and killing over that gold. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that people will then become desperate because of that. They will want that money for themselves, and then when they want to get some of it, they will not be able to attain it. So that greed and that love for the life of this dunya, even if you want to grab it yourself, you will never really be able to hold on to it. In another narration here, and this is in Muslim, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, now what these narrations are telling us is that the Ummah is going to go down. The quality of this Ummah is going to go down. First one, Wahan, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Hubbu al-dunya wa karahiyatul maut. You love the dunya and you hate death. In this hadith, when you find gold, you rush towards it and you stop fighting each other. Muslims fighting each other. In this hadith now, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and this is actually prophecy from him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Iraq will become a very strong country. Egypt will become a very strong country. Sham will become a very strong country. He said in this next hadith that the hour will not be established until the currency of Iraq, the currency of Egypt, and the currency of Sham will become worthless. What does that mean? This Muslim ummah will become debased and at the low, and they will go back to the way they were in the beginning. Why? Not because that they are wrong, not because they've got a wrong religion, it's because of their love and their attachment to the life of this dunya. In another hadith now in Muslim also, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the hour will be established when the Romans are the most populated people on earth. So now this gives us an indication that the Muslims will be a large number, the Romans will be greater, the Muslims will fight these people, but they have a dislike for the Akhirah and they have this connection to the dunya. Some of them will flee and they will be the worst of the people. But not all of them, alhamdulillah. There will always be khair and there will always be goodness. And these people will fight the Romans, even though that they are the greatest populated people in the earth at that time. Now, here is something which is very important. Amr ibn Aas, after this hadith, he narrated from the Messenger of Allah, he then went on to talk about the Romans. I want to ask you a question now. Are we allowed to say good things about the Kuffar or not? If it's true, are we allowed to say good things about the Kuffar or not? You see, some people, they're very extreme in even them being disbelievers. They say, okay, this is a disbeliever, there's nothing good in this person. Amr ibn Aas now gives us six things about the Romans which he says that are good qualities in them. This is a hadith in Muslim, and Amr ibn Aas, obviously this is from himself, but it's also been recorded in Muslim. He said, number one, the Romans will be plentiful on earth that day, on, you know, during that battle, but they have six very good qualities that perhaps Muslims don't have, but Muslims definitely need to benefit from. Number one, they are patient at the time of war. Number two, if a calamity befalls them, they regroup quickly. They don't let it carry on. They don't become disunited. They come back together to think, how can we solve this problem? Number two, they regroup. Number three, they are brave. These are all about war. Now look what he says, just general characteristics. Number four, they help the needy. Romans, they have good manners. Number six, they don't oppress their leaders. Six qualities that he mentions of the Romans. And he said that these are the people that you're going to be fighting. Now, this is something which is very important. We are not trying to entice religious hatred. We're not trying to entice violence or anything of the sort. What we are saying is that these things have been told to us by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we don't want these things to occur, but he told us that they will occur, and they will occur. But it's not that we want them to occur, we want to kill people, because Amr ibn Aas is saying these people are actually good people. But because of the situation that's going to happen, this is a prophecy from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that this is the event that's going to take place. And this is the nature of politics, what happens. 104, on authority Abu Hurairah, and this is in Bukhari and Muslim, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now here are some narrations which talk about the Muslim Ummah just before the coming of the Mahdi. Going back to your question. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and this is in Bukhari and Muslim, لا تقوم الساعة, the hour will not be established, حتى يخرج رجل من قحطان, a man will come from قحطان, and he will be extremely oppressive. From Qahtan. In another narration, his name is Jahjah. The Messenger of Allah وسلم, has given us his name. Now, some of the ulama have said that might not necessarily be his name, it could be a nickname for him. But he is from Qahtan and he is from the Arab. And all of the Muslim countries right now are from asli Arab tribes that can go back to Qahtan. 106. Under authority of Abu Hurairah again, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the hour will not be established until the Muslims fight the Turk. Who are the Turk? Who are the Turk? Huh? It's not the Turks. The Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi explained it to us, huh? The Moguls, yes. They will have hair on their shoes, they will have small eyes, they will have flat noses, and they will be red in their complexion. The hour will not be established until there is a great war before the war with the Romans, and it will occur with the Moguls. And some of the ulama have said that this has already occurred. At the time of Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, with the Tatar, the Moguls, they destroyed and ransacked Muslim countries, they burnt our libraries, they killed ulama, to the extent, wasatiyah, raqiz wasatiyah, why was it written? You know the answer. Why was it Aqid al-Wasatiyah written? Because in Iraq at that time, all or many of the books of the Salaf had been destroyed by these people. So the ulama at that time, they wrote to Ibn Taymiyyah. The ulama wrote to the ulama. Who did they write to? Their major scholar, who was Ibn Taymiyyah at that time. Explain to us the Aqidah and the Manhaj of Ahl al-Sunnah. We know it, but we need a new book because everything has been burned. We need something quick and easy and concise. We can summarize everything that the books from the Salaf have got. This is not to say every single book from the time of the Salaf. We've got Usul al-Sunnah, Sharh al-Sunnah, and all these other books from the ulama of the Salaf, but many have been destroyed. Al-Musta'an. Then the author brings some narrations which talk about the virtue of Sham. Why? Because in Sham, that's where the believers will gather. And this is what we were saying before. The nature of the fitna that's going to occur, quite often people think, okay, when Dajjal comes, I'm going to run to Makkah, I'm going to run to Medina. It's not going to be like that. If only if it was that easy. People think that already, I'm going to make Hijra, I'm going to leave Leicester, and I'm going to go to a Muslim country. It's not going to be like that. Things are going to move in a manner that you probably won't anticipate, you won't understand. Hence the Messenger of Allah said, at that time the Hijra is not going to be to Makkah or Medina. The Hijra, obviously, the Jal will not be able to enter Makkah, we're going to look at it next week. But the Hijra is going to be to Sham. That's where the believers are going to be. In Hadith 113, narrated by Bazzar on authority of Abu Darda. And this Hadith has been made Sahih by Shaykh Rabbani. Bayna ananaim, I was sleeping, and I saw in my dream a book that was lifted from underneath my head, meaning I was sleeping, and there's a book, the Messenger of Allah saw this dream, and it's wahi. There was a book, and it was taken from underneath my head, meaning underneath the pillow if you want, and it was taken. فَذَنَنْتُ أَنَّهُ مَذْهُوبٌ بِهِ. I felt that this book is going to be taken away from me, so I started following where this book is going, and I started walking behind it, and I started looking at this book, the Messenger of Allah. فَذَهَبَ بِهِ إِلَى الشَّامِ. And it ended up in Sham. أَلَا وَإِنَّ الْإِيمَانِ هِينَ تَقَعَ الْفِتْنَةِ بِالشَّامِ. Surely, when the fitna occurs, Iman will be in Sham. Messenger of Allah said this. May Allah make easy the affairs of the people in Sham. In another hadith in Abu Darda, reported by Abu Darda in Abu Dawood, the Messenger of Allah said, that when that intense battle will happen between the Romans and the Muslims, the believers will come towards a place called Ghouta. And Ghouta still exists today. It's a village just on the outskirts of Damascus. And that's where the best of the believers will be. In Abi Shayba, in Musannif, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the fitna will end in Dimashq, because the Dajjal will be destroyed at Bayt al-Maqdis, meaning the fighting will happen and the believers will go towards Dimashq and Sham, and then the Dajjal will be destroyed in Bayt al-Maqdis. So now these two armies will be destroyed where? In Sham. The army of the Romans next to Dimashq and the army of Dajjal at Bayt al-Maqdis. The Dajjal will melt away, his army will still be there, and then, we'll see this next week, then the rocks and the stones and the trees will say to the believers, come, they've got no ruler anymore. There's nothing for you to be scared. Come, fight this person, he's hiding behind me. We know this narration, I'm sure we've heard it before. Then after that, Ya'juj and Ma'juj will come, this is a hadith from Messenger of Allah, they will then be released, and Isa ibn Maryam will take the believers and they will hide in the mountain of Tur. And more detail of that will come later, inshallah. One or two more hadith left, or actually probably this is the last one. In Ibn Majah, from the authority of Abu Hurairah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that after the fighting with the Romans, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will aid the people of Sham on that day. يُؤَدِّ اللَّهُ بِهِ الدِّينِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يُؤَدِّ اللَّهُ بِهِ الدِّينِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will support them and make the religion victorious by these people of Sham on that day. The next hadith that the author brings, and this is in Muslim, in this hadith the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives us 8 major signs before the hour is established. So now what the author is basically saying, the battle takes place, Dajjal is not far after that. After that battle with the Romans, that's it. Each sign is going to come fast and fast and thick and fast, fitna, 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 and the hour is close. Number one, the sun will rise from the west. Remember we said this before. In this hadith, we've got the sun beginning in the west. Is that the first sign or is that the last sign? See, now the ulama have differed. We'll talk about that. In this hadith, Hudhayfa ibn Sa'id, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said that there are going to be 8 major signs before the day of judgment. Number one, the sun will rise from the west. Number two, there's going to be a smoke that's going to drive the people. The Dajjal will come out. Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Isa ibn Maryam will come and defeat him. These are all major signs. Another one from the major signs that there will be 3 eclipses. One in the east, one in the west, and one in Jazirat al-Arab. Now some of the ulama have said eclipse here refers to earthquakes, and we'll talk about that inshallah. Then there will be a fire, and then a beast will be extracted from the land. Meaning, the earth will open up and a beast will come out. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave a description of this beast, and this beast is a monster. And we will see these narrations inshaAllah. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when these occur, there will be no tawbah, and there will be no iman, and no good deed will benefit from this person when these major signs occur. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He protects us and keeps us firm. There are more narrations, but because of time, I think we'll stop there. InshaAllah, next week we'll be looking at the coming of the Dajjal, because what we've done now is we've taken it all the way up to there. So the biggest thing that's going to happen before the coming of the Dajjal is the war with the Romans. The Romans will be defeated. So we've looked at that. Now the believers are going to head towards Sham to face and confront the Dajjal. What's going to happen with the Dajjal when he comes? What fitna is he going to bring, inshallah? There's more description in that in the coming chapter. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He keeps us firm, and that He keeps us upon iman, and that He saves us from all forms of fitna, internal and external. Hada Allahu a'lam. Sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.